Aloha, class. Well, who knew it's the end of the year so soon, huh? It's time to do your final design project, and some of you have come to ask for help, sort of indicating your fear of the osmoregulation and excretion project. So I thought I would just give you a little podcast to help you think through it. It's really pretty simple, especially if you've been keeping up all semester, and you actually have a lot of it done already. So the first thing is to read through the assignment sheet and look here. And okay, so the whole thing is about how does your animal get enough water and how does it manage its salts, right? Okay, so there's two things involved. One is water balance and the other is ion balance. So first of all, of course, what's the first thing we talked about? What was your animal's problem? What habitat did it live in? Was it freshwater, marine, or terrestrial? And of course, that's going to pose some really different challenges for both water and salt balance. So this is where, it's important to know, was it hypoosmotic or hyperosmotic relative to its environment? If it's ureo-osmoconforming, it's probably a shark. So then you're going to want to think about what we talked about here in terms of the intracellular and extracellular ions and what is the ion composition of the osmoconformer. Okay, and if it's a shark, it's going to have this huge urea component, which is really pretty interesting. Okay. Right, what was the osmolarity of the medium? Okay, so especially for anything that touches water, it's going to be really important to know. So the osmolarity of freshwater is about 10 to 50 milliosmoles, and for salt water it's 1,000. So what is its osmotic concentration? Okay, remember we went through this in class and looked at some of the compositions of extracellular fluids. The various osmolarities for different vertebrates are here. So if your animal was terrestrial, of course, it's going to be really important what temperature and relative humidity of the air is. And why is that? Well, of course, because we evaporate. Remember, in design one, we had to figure out the respiratory evaporative water loss and the cutaneous evaporative water loss. Hopefully, you have realistic values for those because then you can just actually plug them in. So don't forget, if your animal is aquatic but it has lungs, it's also going to have respiratory evaporative water loss. Okay, so then you have a qualitative water balance sheet for your animal. So you can actually calculate how much water flux is going to be going through your animal. So one of the big things, of course, is urine. So, where does urine come from? Think about that. It comes from eating proteins, right? So, it's those nitrogens in the amino acids that your body has to excrete. And so, it's either going to produce ammonia, nitrogen, I mean, ammonia, urea, or uric acid. So, remember the stoichiometry for those things is in your supplement 4-1 on page 118. Okay, so it goes through in your book what happens when an animal eats and metabolizes 100 grams of proteins and how many moles of each type of nitrogenous waste is produced. You're going to use that to figure out what the osmotic concentration of your urine is going to be. Okay, so remember that animals with kidneys can produce concentrated urine. Okay, so first of all, you have to figure out what kind of animal do you have and can it concentrate its urine? If it can, then you can figure out the minimum amount of water it needs to excrete the nitrogenous waste product that your animal produces. Okay, so it'll be here in this table. You can also look it up for your specific animal. Okay, but it's mostly gonna be only birds and mammals that can produce a concentrated urine. Other animals will not be able to concentrate. Okay, so so then you just follow through with the rest of this sheet. Okay, so then you can calculate the minimum amount of water it needs, and if it has excess water, well, what's it going to do? It's just going to pee, so it's going to dilute its urine further. If it doesn't have enough water, you have to think, what are the possible ways that it could get more water, and try to incorporate that into your model. Oh, okay, a couple of things I forgot to go over is just on the input side, how does an animal get water? Well, it can drink, it can eat. There's loose water in food. So, you know, if your food items are 70% water, well, then 70% of the weight of your food is going to be water. So there's that much water. There's also metabolic water. Remember, when you go through aerobic metabolism, you're going to consume 6 molecules of oxygen, and for a molecule of glucose, you're going to produce 6 molecules of carbon dioxide and 6 molecules of water. So that water is actually formed through the metabolism of the food that your animal eats. Okay, so there's pretty simple conversion tables here in the production of metabolic water during oxidation of foods table on the handout that I gave you. There's also information in supplement 4-1 in your book. So that's pretty much it. Just follow this and you'll basically be done. So hopefully that helps. Anyway, okay, good luck. Bye-bye.